of them are quite easy, but this one particularly is a little interesting one, though it is a little longer than the rest of them, and I assure all of you that you will enjoy this. The foot, as we all know, is the most neglected part of our body, because we always ignore everything on which we put our weight and the shoulders on which we climb up in our life and the people who work as our subordinates. So is the foot, that it is one of the most ignored part of the body, and we tend to ignore it till it starts telling us that something is really wrong with them. There are many conditions in day-to-day practice of a physician, and especially a pain physician like me, who sees all these foot problems, and it is very difficult to tell one from another. And the crux of the treatment is only when we diagnose and we know really the dynamics of that problem, that we are able to justify with the patients. It is very easy for everybody to take painkillers themselves, or you know, put some heating pads or ice massage, but to really know the different differential diagnosis of different conditions of foot pain will be very interesting, I'm sure, for you. So let me start straight away at the outset. The most common one, you see, there are a lot of small points, so I have decided that rather than speaking extempore, it will be better that I write it down properly so that I don't miss out on any point, and I will try to be as brief and short as possible. So at the outset, the most important condition that I see in my daily practice, before that I would like to just orient you to a foot. You see, a foot is a very dynamic structure which, as our body is made up of, is one is bones and then various ligaments that you can see, and the supporting muscles. And a foot has got a very typical shape, a human foot. It's just not a supporting structure, but you can see that there is an arch. You see, the weight of the whole body is supported only on these two points. One is the heel and one is this ball of the foot. The rest, everything helps us in our locomotion. That is the way we move. And the most important thing that this thing gives us is the gait. How we walk, how we stand, what we do, how we run, what happens when we are running, what happens when we are standing, what happens when we are walking. So all these factors have to be considered, and deformities in those actions basically gives rise to all the problems that I will be discussing today. So the commonest one is, as we all know, most joints and everybody's joint suffers from, right from the age of 20 onwards, is osteoarthritis. See, that is the most commonest thing. And the joints which it affects most is the ankle joint and the small toes. And as all osteoarthritis, people suffer from tenderness, pain, reduced joint movement, stiffness, and you will always see swelling around the ankle. I have seen patients going from one doctor to another just because they get this, some swelling here on this area, and they are being treated for different conditions. But the commonest diagnosis is osteoarthritis of the foot, even young people. So these people basically need little painkillers if they are disturbed by it, but simple footwear with proper support and shape, and increasing the flexibility of their feet, you know, and the joints. And other treatment care that, of course, most of them who are suffering are little on the obese side or very obese. If they are not really able to walk, I always recommend elderly people to take sticks or crutches, and if the pain is very severe, they can have some ice scrubbing, not hot fomentation. The second condition which affects some people is rheumatoid arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis, everybody will call it rheumatism, we all know. But rheumatoid arthritis is an entity by itself, and as it affects different small joints, mainly of the hand, it also affects the small joints of the toes, and it causes lot of deformity. Here what we are seeing is hammer toes and mallet toes. Here is this mallet toe and hallux valgus. You know, the toes are all bent inward. So as it causes destruction in other joints, it also causes destruction in the foot joint. And treatment is, as we do in so many rheumatoid arthritis, we start with simple painkillers and go to steroids. If that does not work, we go to immunomodifying drugs, which is a little difficult part of the treatment. But most of these people need repeated surgical correction to make their lives comfortable. The third condition, which most people may not know or may not have heard of, but it is quite common, is this one condition known as calcaneal apophysitis. Apophysitis is basically reduced blood supply in the heel. We see this mainly in young obese children, you know, who are very hyperactive. They like to jump around and play and go on these things. They go to many doctors complaining of pain in the heel. So these children, basically what happens is because of their overactivities over here, there is reduced blood supply, and this is known as a growth point of the bone of the heel. So it separates out a little because of the reduced blood supply. So we ask these children to rest and just raise up their foot. Basically painkillers or anything does not help in these children. Sometimes we have to put these types of slings or a heel support. Now at this stage, what we need to differentiate when these children come is whether he has got an apophysitis or he has got a spur, bone spur, we call it Hägglund disease, I'll discuss it later on, or they have tendinitis. Because all these three, the causative factors are the same. They jump and run and do all those hyperactivities. So they get one of these. So in the next condition we go to. Now this is the commonest thing which we see in all of us. I'm sure all of us have suffered from one of these conditions at least once in our life. And they are all very well depicted in this one picture. So I'll be discussing this one thing is the Achilles tendinitis. This is the strongest tendon in our body. So this gets inflamed. The second thing is plantar fasciitis. And we see God has supported all these muscles and between the tendons. He has put small bag of oil everywhere in the body. They are known as bursa. I have discussed many types of bursa in my previous talks, and so the foot has also many bursa. So we see these two types of bursa. One bursa is between the skin and this Achilles tendon, and one bursa is between the Achilles tendon and this bone, the heel bone. We call that calcaneus. So it is known as retrocalcaneal bursitis. So all these conditions put together are very common. Now the cause is same for everything. One is a repetitive trauma. So see, a person who is wearing very tight shoes is one, which are rubbing with the back. You know, sometimes we buy shoes in the just for the rainy season, and they are known as pump shoes, which does not have lace. So they go on rubbing with the back, and it causes this. This is that retrocalcaneal bursitis. And especially ladies who are wearing these laceless pump shoes with either big heels or such stilettos, which are not very common in our country, but abroad, and most of the ladies will find wearing all these things. So when they walk, the heel goes up and down and it goes on rubbing. So they get this bursa gets swollen. So we call that, there's a very typical name for it. It is known as a pump bump syndrome. So these are all pump shoes and they are pumping with the heel. So we call that a pump bump syndrome. One is this. And second is when they go on getting this, there is a spur of bone grows on that side. It is known as Hägglund's deformity. See, there is, you can see a spur of bone. Same that a spur of bone has grown over here, and a spur sometimes grows over here. So this spur is known as Hägglund's deformity. It has got a typical name from that person who described this spur and why this thing occurs. So we get pain at the back of the heel. We have to differentiate that what is the condition. Now, if you see a swelling like this over here, then it is a retroachilles bursitis over here. But this one, you have to hold this Achilles tendon with your thumb and finger tightly, and then if the patient feels pain over here, then we know that this bursa is inflamed. That is one thing. Plantar fasciitis is one condition. Go back. Plantar fasciitis. plantar fascia is what is plantar fascia? It is a ligament which joins the heel to the toes and it maintains the arch of that foot as I talked to you. So this point over here gets inflamed. So a person feels pain very classically, you know, when he's sitting down or when he sleeps, and when you will ask him, when he puts his first few steps as he just comes out of the bed, he will get severe pain over here. After walking for about 20-30 steps, then he feels alright. That is plantar fasciitis. Similarly, when plantar fasciitis occurs, because again improper shoes, and the commonest cause is weight. If the person has got a lot of weight and he is actually pressing his plantar, this heel with the fascia, so he is going to get this pain over here. So what is plantar fasciitis? When this plantar fasciitis is very chronic for a long time, then this bone grows a spur. You can see that calcaneal spur over here. This is a spur. So what is spur? In that area of inflammation where this swelling is there, this swelling gradually gets ossified. You know, bone is put over here. So it develops the spur. When this spur grows, then the treatment becomes more difficult and surgery is the last option. But whenever plantar fascia is there, then the best thing we ask is, one is we ask them to put heel pads, soft heel pads in the shoes. But most of the time it does not work, because the cause of getting this plantar fasciitis is not just his weight, but he develops poor muscles everywhere in the body. So these poor muscles are not able to support his leg, and that is why the weight is transformed over here. So the best thing to do is to strain his muscles of the foot and do these kinds of exercises, what you are seeing. You know, these heel stretch, the muscles stretch, and we ask them to do this about 50 to 100 times when they get up, right? And strengthening these calf muscles. So these exercises, foot stretch exercises, are the best solution for these kinds of pain. That is Achilles tendinitis, plantar fasciitis, calcaneal spur, and Hegeland deformity. Unfortunately, the only treatment, as I show you that spur on this, the back of the knee over here. The only treatment is surgery. This man is removing that Hegeland deformity. So, see, these four conditions are the commonest condition that I see in my day-to-day practice as a pain physician. Now, we are going to one of the most important, before that there are few small conditions which I see not very commonly, but we do see. What is a Morton's neuroma? Now, what is a neuroma? Neuroma is a swelling of the nerve. Now those ladies, you know, who are used to wearing pointed shoes, or even men, now, I mean, it is too much in vogue. So in such condition, what happens? That all the toes are cramped into the front part of the shoes, and these nerves, they get large, they get inflamed. And the symptom is that when they are just walking, they walk for a few steps, and then they have to remove their shoes and they massage their legs. When they rest for some time, again the pain goes down, and the pain is like an electric shock, because it is a nerve which is inflamed. So these people, it's a very pitiable sight. You will see them walking for some distance, then again sitting down on some hand cart, and they massage their legs. So one of the treatment is giving them a steroid injection into their nerve, and it solves the problem. But if it does not solve, then surgery is the last option, when they remove only the fiber of the nerve and they become alright. We tell them to come to these kind of wide-toed shoes. There should be at least a space of 1.5 inches between the toe and the edge of the shoe. That is the right treatment to do. So Morton's neuroma is one. Second is a stress fracture. Now, stress fracture we don't commonly see in cities, but in villages we do see. It is also known as a march fracture, because armies were made to march for very long distances. They do get. People who try to do too much in too little time, or those of us who are not, you know, really used to walking for long distances, like we take up long walks or do too much of activities, basketball players, they get this stress fracture. Now these are very, you know, very small hairline fracture which you may miss even on an x-ray. The only sign over here that you are seeing is that the bone is trying to heal by throwing calcium around. called as callus. That is how we know that there is a fracture over here. The only other way is a CT scan or an MRI. So stress fracture, it goes away with rest. You ask the person to rest, the bone heals. But if he is not able to do, many a time we are forced to plaster the leg and put it in a plaster cast. So that is what stress fracture is all about. We see this very commonly in villages and in small towns. Gout, most of you have heard what is gout, and you know that it is basically a disorder of uric acid metabolism. There are some people who produces normal uric acid, but the kidneys are not able to throw out that uric acid. So when these uric acid crystals, they accumulate in joints, they give sudden inflammation. Now why I have included this in the foot is, the classical gout as it is described in textbook is the big toe of the left foot. That is what gives, you know, suddenly they get up in the morning and the whole foot is inflamed, it is red, it is stinging, and it is so painful that person, it's like maddening. He doesn't know what to do. It can affect any joint, but this is one of the classical presentations. Any joint can be affected by gout. Now these people are usually obese. So the treatment of gout is reduction of obesity. And there are certain foods which gives rise to more uric acid. So we ask them to reduce those food like cheese, chocolates, beer and non-veg food. You see what I wanted to say in this meeting is gout is such a common condition which is diagnosed by physicians. Because whenever the normal uric acid level is only about 7 to 8. And when they see uric acid 8 to 9, people diagnose gout. It's not so. When the blood uric acid is more than 30 to 40, then only it has to be gout. And gout is only diagnosed by aspirating the fluid from the joint and seeing the crystals of uric acid in a microscope. Then it is surely gout. Otherwise, there are many conditions which can give gout. The common treatment is when an acute inflammation occurs, we give a drug known as colchicine along with painkillers and the inflammation goes down. And after that, people are advised to take Xyloric, a tablet which throws away the uric acid for lifetime. So gout is one common condition. Now, this is the second part of the lecture. This is very important. What we are trying to discuss is that how God has made this food. It's really a marvel of nature that the way this foot is made, and we tend to ignore our foot and, you know, we misuse it or abuse it. So we have to understand the structure of our foot and what are the different abuses that we do. So the first thing that I would like you to know is that the foot has got arches. The foot is like a dome or like an elongated dome, and it has got two or three arches. So one is this cross arch just behind the balls of the toes. This is the inner arch and this is the outer arch. All these arches is what gives you the springing of the foot and this smooth walk that we do and we take it for granted. All these arches are lost in people like you and me who are in cities, used to wear foot and our shoes and fancy footwear. Villagers and people who are used to walk barefoot in jungles will never ever lose this thing and will never get any of the problems that I'll be describing now. So you have to understand these arches. We go to the next further discussion of this. The first thing that people do suffer, and you must be seeing so commonly, I'm sure everybody will be having elderly people in the house, that they get what is known as a flat foot syndrome. In this flat foot syndrome, what actually happens is that all these arches are supported by ligaments and muscles which gives them this dome which you are seeing. So these muscles are on this side and on the other side, they lose their tone, their flexibility and their strength, and gradually the foot becomes flat. It becomes flat like this. So all these problems start. So at the onset, when these pains come because of the loss of arches, we give them this arch supports. It is known as a valgus pad in medical language. But this is one of the common things. Now we have got regular slippers also which are available, which has got these kinds of supports. So this is a flat foot. Now as people ignore this flat foot, they don't do the exercise and all these things, they gradually go to a condition which is this. This is known as pronated foot. Now, what happens in a pronated foot? In a pronated foot, after the flat foot, as it progresses, you see, everybody, when we put our foot, we put it with our, we put it like this, it should come straight. Instead of this, the foot starts falling on the inner side first. First the inner side falls, then the outer side falls. First the inner side falls on the ground, and then the outer side falls. This becomes because of progressive obesity, bad footwear and posture. And people, you know, usually who are in a working class, labor class people, they this is what they get, that the foot uses loses the axis of its dynamics. And then the different things are. You may be seeing so many shoes like this, some of guests coming to the house, that one side of the sole has been rubbed off. So we ask them to put a wedge, a heel wedge over here. And these are some of the exercises which I'll demonstrate to you later to prevent the further progress of this pronated foot syndrome. Now, plantar fasciitis, calcaneal bursitis are nothing but end results, or the that is the cause and this is the effect. So those people actually are getting flat foot syndrome, and not the arches are not well supported, they start getting this plantar fasciitis. That is why one of the first things doctors do is to give this heel support. But these heel supports don't help much. They eventually have to go for further treatment. One of the other conditions is to do these exercises, which I will describe later. So plantar fasciitis. Second thing which people get is this one condition known as tarsal tunnel syndrome. The spelling is wrong over here, it has to be S-A-L. Now, what is a tarsal tunnel syndrome? This is a very common condition in more or less in our country, but more in Western countries. There is a small nerve which you see over here. It is known as a posterior tibial nerve, which supplies nerve supply to the inner foot and even the front foot, just on the upper side. This nerve gets caught in this canal. This is the tarsal canal, as it is known as, because there are so many tendons. So as this nerve gets trapped, these people get continuous burning sensation, or hot and cold sensation, or lightning pains while walking, or even at night. Some people whose legs are in plaster, their nerve gets trapped, and this they complain of severe pain. It is really intolerable. So this tunnel is formed by this retinaculum, or this fascia, or this ligament, which tries to hold all this tendon behind the inner ankle. This is the inner ankle. That side is the outer ankle. So behind the inner ankle, all these tendons between that this nerve is trapped, and they go on getting this pain. One of the best treatment for this is to just give a small dose of a local anesthetic, that is lignocaine. Immediately they get relief. Once you know that they get relief, you can give local this lignocaine along with little steroid, and they become all better. Same way on the other side, that is the outer heel. That was the inner heel, or on the outer heel. There is something known as the posterior tibial tendinitis. No, this is also the inner heel. This is a tendon. That was a nerve which was trapped in the inner heel, in the tarsal canal. In the same canal, we are able to see some tendons. Tendons are end points of muscles. So one of the muscles which get trapped is this posterior tibial tendon. Now, when this muscle get trapped, this area of the body, all of you should remember, has got the least blood supply than anywhere else in the body. Suppose anything gets damaged, or this bone is fractured over here, or this tendon gets broken, it is very, very, very difficult for it to heal again. So, and this is the posterior tibial tendon has got a very critical blood supply. So, because it is getting trapped, it does not get blood supply and it becomes inflamed. So, we ask the patient to put this cast or a tibial cast, and we ask them to rest. You can see this pronated foot syndrome. Means a flat foot and a pronated foot are the mother and father of getting all these different conditions that I am describing right now. So we ask them to rest. If they are not able to rest, we put them in a cast. If they are not able to do it, then surgically we get this fascia, this ligament removed, and they become all better. You will be seeing this condition very, very commonly in high class ladies, in high society ladies, in certain communities like Parsis, this is genetic. You can see the toe, it has gone wayward, it has gone outward. Outward means valgus. So if hallux means toes, then outward means valgus. And the whole bone is deformed like this, this joint. And because of that, they get inflammation of bursa over here. We call it bunion. And we ask them to first is to change the shoes, because they are all used to wearing those pointed sandals. Long back when you wear pointed sandals. And we put this kind of, drapes, or there are such orthoses available, these kind of contraptions which keeps the toe apart. That is the first thing we do. If it is not possible, then we get this bone, this metatarsal, it cut from here, and then the orthopedic surgeon straightens the toe. Otherwise, this is a very painful condition, and you will see really deformed toes. So, hallux valgus is also one of the effects of the flat foot syndrome. Because of hallux valgus, as I told you, that God has made many bursa or bags of oil. That is because these things do not get unnecessarily compressed. So there are two bursas, one is over here and one is over here. They get inflamed and thickened. So we call this bunion, and this is known as bunion neck, because this is a small on the small finger. So we try to put these kind of paddings and contractors to prevent this bunion. Sometimes we have to give steroid injections for immediate pain. Most common condition, everybody who are used to wearing hard soles or walking barefoot in their houses or flat toes or pronated foot syndrome is metatarsal here. Basically, metatarsals are bones over here. Before, after these toes, the bones which we see, the long bones are known as metatarsals. So these joints of metatarsals, just like arthritis, they get inflamed, they get arthritis. So it is a very painful condition. We definitely use pain killers and wax bars and everything, but these are all metatarsal pads which are commonly available in the market, and we advise them. And we advise them foot exercises, as I showed you. Other, just in the same way as metatarsal, sometimes, as I told you, that there is a very important fact which I want to tell you, that you see, when we are walking, one third of the body weight falls on these two toes, and the remaining three toes, two third of the body weight falls on this. Sometimes when this metatarsal is there, all the body weight comes on this one joint, and this toe gets necrosed, you know, it shrinks, it shrivels, and it gets all crumpled up. So it is known as avascular necrosis, AVN. You will hear avascular necrosis very commonly in the hip joint, especially people who are addicted to alcohol or steroids or taking some cancer drugs. So in such a case, we have to get this toe removed and we have to do a bone graft. Same way, as I told you, for posterior tibial tendinitis, on the other side of the foot, that is inner side, this is known as a peroneal tendinitis. It is also a sequelae of flat foot and pronated foot. In these cases, we advise them to wear slippers or varus pad. In those tendinitis, that is posterior tibial tendinitis, the lump is of, or the elevation of the slipper is on this side. In these slippers, it is on the inner side. And we ask them to do exercises or to rest. And sometimes we have to remove this fascia from it. Now, in rheumatoid arthritis, in this flat foot, pronated foot, sometimes people are so careless, and when they, you see, the nutrition is bad, that all the tendons, all the muscles, rather than supporting these bones, they pull away the bones here and there, and we get all these distorted toes. So two of the most common things which we see, even in rheumatoid arthritis, hallux valgus, is one is a hammer toe, that means it's like this, and one is a mallet toe. A mallet is one-sided hammer. And we see this, and because of this, you know, this point rubs with the inner side of the shoes, and they get inflamed. So this is also known as a bunion. These are all bursas. So these get inflamed and they are very, very painful. All these people will eventually need surgery. We try to give them relief by putting these pads, and sometimes we stab their toes, but they don't really work. Now this is the most important part. These are all different exercises. I have brought a chart which I would like to give to all of you. But the best exercises is stretching the heel, and you know, so that strengthens these muscles, the calf muscles. They have shown it over here also. In all these heel conditions, I personally advise everybody, I mean, this is the most easiest thing a person can do in their house. And other exercises is like this. Instead of a towel, he has to pick the towel from one point and then put it on another point. Or even a little more difficult one is to ask him to pick up marbles from one can, one pot, and put it into another ball. Marbles. So these are all different exercises which strengthen the toes, the tendons, the muscles, and the calf muscles. And eventually they overcome these conditions which are degenerative. So it is very essential to diagnose and to understand the dynamics of the foot, the muscles, the ligaments, and what will eventually happen and how to stop it rather than treat it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.